I'm Thorsten Altenkirch, and I'm going to present our paper, The Integers as a Higher Inductive Type. So that's a joint work with Luis Scocola, who is or was until recently a PhD student in Canada and who visited me last summer, and that's what we have done. Okay, so this talk is about homotopy type theory, doing something within homotopy type theory. So I thought maybe I should say a few words about type theory in general and HOT in particular. I think many people think type theory is mainly about formal proofs and formal developments. And while this is true, for me there is another perspective on type theory. It's for me it's a way to think about mathematical constructions. So it's also important for doing mathematics informally. And more specifically about homotopy type theory, if you look at the publications, some of the publications, you may think it's mainly about formalizing homotopy theory or algebraic topology. And while this sort of approach to synthetic homotopy theory is quite important and interesting, I think there is more to homotopy type theory than this. And I think it's also very important for computer science. So one important aspect of type theory is that we hide implementation details. And by doing this, we enable abstraction. Type theory is different to set theory in that all operations are structural, or you could say extensional. So in type theory, I cannot talk about the elements in isolation, which I can do in set theory. And hence, I cannot really distinguish different implementations of the same concept. So for example, in set theory, I can distinguish different implementations of the natural numbers, let's say. In type theory, I can't. So this is a feature already of normal, let's say, intentional type theory. But intentional type theory is a bit like a boarding school run by nuns, where there is lots of discipline and you don't get anything back for it. So you're very disciplined, all the operations are structural, but you don't get any new proofs from it. HOT is sort of the payback. By adding the univalence principle, we say, okay, if everything we can see is extensional, then this extensional equality, extensional equivalence, is equality. So in a sense, I would say, HOT is a theory of abstract data types. By abstract data type, I mean that objects can only be seen from outside. We cannot talk about the implementation. And hence, two objects which behave the same are the same, equal for us. Okay? So that's a very, very important idea. Now, adopting this principle, or this idea, has some consequences. So, in particular with respect to equality. So we are used to the idea that equality is a predicate, or in the language of type 3, you could say equality is propositional. In that if you compare two elements, you get a truth value. And by truth value, I don't necessarily mean a Boolean, but something which only tells us about the truth, nothing else. Yeah? So that's what we call propositional. However, what extensional equality of structures, let's say something like monoids or some other algebraic structure, so two monoids are really equal if they are isomorphic. And we cannot distinguish isomorphic monoids. Hence, this is the right notion of equality. However, isomorphism is not a proposition because there is a choice of an isomorphism, which is non-trivial. So hence, what we can say is that equality of structures is a structure, not a proposition. And this very simple fact has some consequences in our constructions. And this talk today, I want to look at a particular consequence, particular example of what happens if you adopt this principle. And as you've seen from the title, I'm going to talk about a very simple type, the integers. Now, how do I define the integers in type theory? I'm going to present a sequence of attempts with different properties. And I'm going to use acta, or actually cubical acta, as the language. So the first way to define the integers is like very naive, and maybe the first thing you would think of. We say an integer is either zero or positive or negative, and positive and negative integers are given by natural numbers. So pos of zero is plus one, and neg of zero is minus one. There are some variations of the scheme. You can have only two cases or use a Boolean for the sign or whatever. It's all the same. So this is a very, very simple representation of the integers, and it has some nice properties. As I already mentioned, we know that the equality of numbers is a proposition of natural numbers, and it applies that this representation of the integers has also propositional equality. It's an H set, as we say. It's a simple, very simple type. So that's good. But there are some downsides to this representation. A student of mine, Noah, once tried to prove properties of the integers using this representation. And it gets very, very sort of complicated. So like, if you want to prove associativity of multiplication over addition, you end up in case distinction hell. You know, you make lots of very weird case distinctions. So I would say this is not a good representation. It's like, in a sense, it's like the normal form representation. And if you think about lambda calculus, if we would just use normal forms to represent lambda terms, that's a very weird calculus. And I think of, if I think of lambda terms, I think of lambda abstraction and the beta rule. It's a much more natural way to reason about lambda terms. And it's similar if we take this representation of the integers. But what are the alternatives? Okay, so there is quite a standard representation in math. Integers are represented as pairs of natural numbers, and they're identified, it's a quotient, if the difference is the same. That's one possibility, but coming from type theory, I quite like inductive definitions. And here's an inductive definition of the integers. I say the integers, so it's our second attempt, our integers are given by zero, successor, and predecessor, and then I have two equations that successor and predecessor are inverse to each other. Now, this is an inductive definition in the sense of homotopy type theory, as a higher inductive type. In we don't just have constructors for elements, but also constructors for equality. And this is quite natural because in HOT, we view a type together with all its equalities, all the tower of equalities. So when we do an inductive construction, we are able not just to add elements, but also to add equalities. And that's exactly what I do here. These SP and PS are sometimes called path constructors. So, okay, is this a good representation of the integers? Nah, there is another problem. So if you look at this example, successor of predecessor of successor of zero should be just one, successor of zero. But there are two ways to see this. So either we can use the fact that pred of sac disappears, and then it's a congruence with respect to successor, or we use that sac and pred are inverse, and use this at sac of zero. So these are two proof terms here. And these two proof terms, they're just created from our constructors. So there is really no reason why they should be equal. Right? And hence, this version of the integers hasn't got a propositional equality, which is already weird. It's not an H set. And consequence of this is that we cannot decide the equality. That seems to be a bit weird. and it's a consequence of Hertberg's theorem. Hertberg's theorem tells us that a type with a decidable equality also has a trivial equality, propositional equality, hence is an H set. So that's positively weird. We certainly want to have integers whose equality is decidable. Okay, so how can we fix this? The first attempt to fix this, the third attempt now to define the integers, is using a big hammer. We flatten all these proofs. We add another constructor which says any two proofs that two integers are equal are equal. Again, this is an equality of an equality over the integer, so it's a well-defined hit, higher inductive type. We can do this. But is it a good idea? Here is the downside. When we define a function from these integers I've just defined into a type, I have to give an interpretation of all the constructors, in particular the last one, and that means I have to show that X itself has a trivial equality, is an H set. So that means I can only define functions from these integers into another H set. But sometimes I may want to define functions from the integers to something which is not an H set, or I may not know it's an H set. So an example for this is the proof that the equality of the circle are the integers. And in this construction, I define a function from the integers to this equality before knowing that it's actually a set. So I would not be allowed to do this. And in general, I would say I want to play around with the integers and my structures and not be limited to H sets. Well, that's not so good. Okay, here's the next attempt. We just add one, instead of this big hammer, I'm going to use a screwdriver, and I just add one equality. I call this Koch, which is basically the generalization of this counterexample we have just seen. Now, the question is this enough? Does this kill all these higher equalities? So if you look at this, if you have studied HOT, you may notice that the four last constructors are exactly one of the possible definition of an equivalence in HOT. And that's quite good because equivalence is actually a proposition. Being an equivalence is a proposition. It's trivial. It's at most one proof of it. So okay, that looks quite promising. So now, how do we go about this? We want to define a normalization function, which is basically maps these integers I've just defined into the normal forms, the first definition of the integers, and I know these ones are set. And I have an inverse, I have an embedding from my normal forms into these integers I've just defined. This is quite easy to define, and what I need to show is that these two are inverse, so that they are isomorphic to the integers, that my Z4 is isomorphic to Z1. To prove that, in particular, I have to prove this lemma here, that amp of nf of x equals to x. And this one is actually a bit tricky, because I have to do some induction over the integers with these complicated path equalities. And it turns out that this is quite hard, because we really have to have these path constructors, so all these constructions take place in higher dimensions. Not normal sort of category theory, but it's really higher category theory we need there. So that's, we haven't actually tried this, so it looks not very promising. But hang on. As I said before, being an equivalence is a proposition. So hence, in a way, only suck and zero should matter. The rest is irrelevant. So to be more precise, we should be able to show that any two functions out of the integers which agree on zero and which behaves the same way on successor are equal. If you have shown this, then it's quite straightforward to prove the theorem I've just mentioned, to prove this lemma, because I only have to check this equality for zero and for successor. However, it turns out it's not so easy. And here I should really thank Paolo Capriotti, who initiated lots of this work. And he also pointed out that it's not so easy. We cannot always ignore the part of morphisms which have to do only with propositional components of an algebra. And here's got a very nice, very simple counterexample. So here we have I'm using here Acta syntax again. We have a type with a binary operation, and I force it to be a set, and it has an element which is a left unit and a right unit. Now it's quite easy to say that this information here is a proposition, because any two units are going to be equal. They can be at most one unit. However, it's not the case that an algebra morphism, which is just defined on these components, will necessarily preserve the unit. And that means that the sort of general argument that this part is propositional, hence we can ignore it, doesn't work. However, all is not lost. We can actually, in this case, assuming initiality of the integers, initiality with respect to notion of algebras and algebra morphisms, we can show that the particular morphisms which are relevant here actually behave like this. The part which has to do with the equivalence can be ignored, and we can prove this lemma here. By the way, we don't know a general criterion for this. So if you have an algebra with a propositional part, under what circumstances can you ignore this propositional part in the morphisms? However, we wanted to formalize this in cubical acta. Now, cubical acta allows us to define these higher inductive types and do pattern matching over it, or use the eliminator, if you like. And we need to show now that this implies initiality. So that's a triviality for ordinary inductive types, like natural numbers and so on. But if you have higher constructors, it can get quite complicated. And in this example, in this particular case, we needed to construct a filler for a four-dimensional cube. And basically, my proof engineer went on strike for this. Wasn't going to do this. It's too boring. So we want to show that any two morphisms from the initial algebra are equal. Okay, so what's the alternative? So that's yet another representation of the integers, and it's another formulation of what's an equivalence. A bit surprising to say that something is an equivalent. We have two predecessors here, a right predecessor and a left predecessor, and so we have these two laws, and actually that's also a way to state that successor is an equivalence, but it's a bit better behaved, because we only have ordinary equalities, no higher equalities, and that makes the proof much more feasible. So indeed, we were able to show initiality, and in one point in the proof, we actually had to prove this initiality, to prove that this pattern matching applies initiality, we actually had to fill a cube. And filling a cube is a higher dimensional version of like completing a commutative diagram. So here in this cube, we can show that all these faces on the bottom and on the sides, they commute, and hence by pasting them together, we know that the top face commutes. And for the other representation, for the previous representation of the integers, we have to do something similar, but in this case, it's a four-dimensional cube, and that creates lots of extra work. Okay, so the result we have is that using this normalization idea, and again using this key lemma, we can show that this representation of the integers is equivalent isomorphic to the normal form integers, and we can do this formally, or we have done it formally using cubical octa, and hence as a corollary we know that the integers we've just defined are an H set. Okay, so let me make some concluding remarks. We can generalize this result to show that the free group of a decidable set is a set. I'm here talking about H sets in the sense of HOT. What we have just shown is the free group is one generators, which is the integers are set. But on paper, at least, we can generalize this construction easily to a type with a decidable equality, decidable set. In general, it's open whether the free group of an H set is an H set. We have got a paper with Nikolai Kraus in LIX 2018, where we show that show a partial result that if you limit the higher proofs one level higher, you limit them to be groupoids, then you can show this result. But if you don't do this, that's still open. Also about this problem, which we encountered, to show that eliminators and initiality are equivalent, actually. So if you have an eliminator, dependent eliminator, then you can prove initiality, and initiality implies that there is an eliminator, that you can show this for arbitrary higher inductive types that Christian Sattler has given in an unpublished proof. And I would like to understand this is good enough to at least be able to derive a tactic for octa to do this, for cubical octa. And finally, maybe a more interesting example of a coherence problem is the definition, the intrinsic definition of the syntax of types theory. So the syntax of types theory is an initial CWF, and this was in a proper paper with Ambrosch Capozzi. And here we also, if we work in HOT, we have to truncate the syntax because we wanted the syntax of type theory is an H set and has a decidable equality. We need to set truncate the syntax as we have done in one of the earlier integer examples, use a hammer. But the problem, the downfall is that we cannot even show that there is a, we cannot interpret our syntax in the standard model of sets, because we would have to interpret context as sets, and the type of sets, of H sets, isn't itself an H set. So this is also a similar problem, and way out of it is in replacing the hammer by a more specific coherence constructors, which then imply that this is a set without limiting the elimination power of this type. Okay, thank you very much for listening.